Good morning, everybody.
Howdy.
This is Nelly Lugo. Did I pronounce that right?
Yes, Nelly Lugo, yes.
Good.
She has a YouTube channel. Yes? Go ahead.
Yes. Well, my YouTube channel is like my name, Nelly Lugo. That's it. Simple.
Yes.
And you're doing your videos in Spanish to reach the Spanish Jehovah's Witnesses. That's correct?
Yes.
Good.
Yes, that's correct. I started like a year and a half. I started doing it. You know, I started with a 5 minutes video, and now I have to stop on it because it's getting like 40. I said, oh my God, I went too far. That's the way it is.
It's actually easier for us to do a longer video than it is a shorter video because there's just so much information that needs to get out there, especially, you know, about the Watchtower Society.
Yes, it's true. And sometimes, you know, I write my notes, and when I finish, I say, oh my gosh, I forget to say something. So there are some notes that I forget to say it because it's so much to say, like you said, Mike, it's a lot. You know, people want to hear it. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. But we appreciate you and the other activists that are doing videos in Spanish because, you know, these videos need to get out there in every language.
Well, not only that, also in the, you know, German language because we're in contact with ex-Jehovah's Witnesses that are doing videos in German. And it's, I mean, right now, the way activism is going, especially on YouTube, we're reaching potentially every Jehovah's Witness on this earth.
Yes, and you know, when I started looking at my age, I'm 75 now, I saw myself like the oldie there, you know, and I was kind of ashamed at first, you know, this old lady is talking in YouTube, but then my grandkids says, oh, Grandma, you're here in YouTube, wow. So they were so proud of me, I said, I have to continue doing this. You know, people like it, people... my grandkids feel proud of me, what I'm doing. I need to do something.
Good.
And I continue, and then when I reached like 100 people, I was like, oh my God, 100 people already saw my video. And that encouraged me to continue because I saw people that need to hear the message. So here is still.
Yeah. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but Kim had a conversation with you earlier, and you had mentioned that in the Spanish culture, the Jehovah's Witnesses don't really shun family members, even if they leave Watchtower, like what, you know, us white privileged Americans would do. Is that a true statement?
Exactly. No, some people shun, but like in front of the elders,
yeah,
and people from the Kingdom Home, but they try to see their family behind, you know, those curtains of the elders and everything. But some of them, they go by what the organization says, and they don't. Some people, they haven't seen their kids for years.
Okay.
They, you know, it's getting into us too. You know, to the Spanish community, the shunning is getting bad too.
Okay, so this is basically then just like a recent development among the Spanish-speaking Jehovah's Witnesses.
I would say that it's more than 5 years, like 5 years or so, that they are, you know, they are already showing. But like I said, some people, they don't care about what the organization says, and they try to stay in communication with their kids. But some of them are already showing completely. They haven't seen their kids for years. And it's sad because, you know, one of the things that the Hispanic community has is family. We are very into family. We are family oriented, and they are separating families, and it's very sad.
Yeah.
Very sad.
Yes. Yeah. The person I was talking to, they live in the Southwest here of the United States, and they said that they had told me that their culture is very family oriented. And I know living here in New Mexico, you know, same thing. It's all about family. And even the Catholics who are excommunicated, the family will still, you know, talk to them, and, you know, they don't pay any attention to the excommunicating of the church. So, you know, it probably depends on what area, you know, you're from.
Well, I haven't seen many people in Puerto Rico. For some reason, if they're writing to me in comments or things like that, they don't identify as Puerto Ricans. And it's kind of strange, you know. Some people ask me and say, oh, I'm Puerto Rican. And so I don't know too much about us. But I've received calls and messages from South America. Mm. And some people are already suffering the shunning. I have this father of four, and his wife. They start looking, you know, watching videos because of something that happened, that it clicked on him that something was wrong. And after he decided to watch all the Hispanics videos and everything, he decided that he would not, you know, go back to the kingdom home. But he committed the mistake of sending a letter to his sisters, you know,
wow,
sisters, and saying that he was not going back, that he was going to send the letters, DS letters and everything. So you know what they did? They called the elders. They sent the letters to the elders, and those six were disfellowshipped ahead of time. They didn't say anything. They disfellowship, and then they call in. I said, you all are disfellowship. So, you know, right now, even in our community, the shunning is very, very hard. It's very bad.
Yeah.
And it's sad. It's sad, yeah. Because we talk about our God, you know, the thing that we precious more, the most, is our family. That's for, you know, forever, yeah, that I remember. And right now, they don't even care about funding. They care only about the organization.
Yeah. See, exactly. And that's what they've done, is they've weaponized and used psychological abuse, you know, of families against families.
See, and that's what I find so hypocritical in this culture that Watchtower has created, is that we're sitting in the Kingdom Hall and we're told time and time again, in the Garden of Eden, Satan separated Jehovah from the human family. See, Satan is causing this, but yet as a culture of Jehovah's Witnesses, they're doing the same damn thing, and they can't recognize what they're doing, that they're doing the exact same thing that Satan did, supposedly back in the Garden of Eden. And it's like, why can't you see this? It's like, why? I mean, it's just as plain as the nose on anybody's face. They sit there and tell you, this is what Satan did. Watchtower separates the family, and it's like, oh, praise Jehovah. Wow.
Well, I was so upset one time in a discussion with somebody that I said, listen, if you look at the Bible, if you read the Bible, I don't see anything that Satan has done here. So whatever I see is that Jehovah been doing so many things.
Yeah.
You know? So I don't know what to believe. And I'm sorry, I said that at the moment, but you know, everything that happens in the organization, they turns to Satan. And you know, we are Satan kids, and everything is Satan. And people are so afraid of Satan, you know, that even when you buy something in a used store or whatever, oh, be careful, because you know, Satan can possess that.
Yeah, it's demonized.
Whatever. It's a Satan situation, you know. I don't know what it is.
I know it. Before I forget, I wanted to mention Zalkin's new website that he has launched, justiceforabusevictims.com. And it's set up for these abuse survivors. And so I was going to ask you to just mention that in Spanish real quick for our Spanish viewers.
Oh, gracias, Kim West. Kim va a mencionar ahora la nueva forma de cómo comunicarse con la firma de abogados Zolkin. Así que por favor estén atentos a los teléfonos y la dirección que ella va a dar para que puedan comunicarse con ellos y ofrecerles a ellos toda la información que ustedes tienen para recibir ayuda.
Gracias.
Bueno. I don't, but, let's see. What's the word? Poquito. Poquito. Little bit.
You said like two true words and I said a paragraph.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's Spanish.
Yep.
And I've noticed that the Spanish here in New Mexico is just slight, some of the words are slightly different than like some of the Spanish words you might use. You know, but it just depends on what part of the United States, you know, you're in.
Depends on the Hispanic area, like South America, you know, they speak completely different as us. By the way, we use a lot of American words, you know, we like mix already because of the American culture here in Puerto Rico and being a Commonwealth of the United States. Words now are mixed, you know, with the American words. So, good. You know, half of our language is
yes. Since you're doing this Skype interview and this Sunday morning, it's safe to assume that Puerto Rico survived the Hurricane Dorian okay?
Oh, Mikey, we were so afraid after, you know, having Maria destroy our island. Some people were in distress, where everyone was scary. I went to buy some water, I couldn't find any.
Oh, wow.
But for good for us, instead of changing, you know, the route and changing on the way, that we barely have what? Rain. Barely nothing. I was asking for rain at least. And we have like a day of rain because I live in the south. The south is dry, completely dry, and very humid and completely hot. The heat kills us. But we only have like a day of rain. That was it. Nothing happened and we are being blessed.
Good.
It's difficult. Yeah, another hurricane after Maria that destroyed the whole island. It was sad.
Well, we're so glad that you and the island are okay. And I was going to ask you, we had done a video yesterday and I couldn't remember. For some reason, it was sticking in my mind that Puerto Rico, you know, that Maria, that the JW broadcast was thanking Jehovah that their branch wasn't damaged. Do you remember? Was that Puerto Rico or was that another country?
I really don't know about that. Yeah. I didn't hear about it.
Okay.
But let me tell you this about helping, you know, the JW's health. I received a message from Venezuela, and he said, please say something, because I told the guy that I was, or the person that I was talking to you guys, please say something. He told me that the people from Venezuela are surviving the JW's because of the JW's in the States. Not because of the organization. They don't give them anything.
It's the individuals.
He said not even a grain of rice grain, nothing.
Wow.
They survive it because people, you know, JWs and ex-JWs are sending their family, they're sending money, they're sending, you know, through other countries, they're sending food and other things. Plus, he said, the Catholic Church and Mormons are helping too. They haven't seen not even nothing from the JWs, and that is nasty.
Amazing.
They've been helping. Oh, we've been helping, sending to Venezuela. He says nothing we have received from them.
Wow. That's actually good news in the way, because it just confirms everything that every activist has been saying. Watchtower will not help its own people.
And they won't tell the truth either, because, you know, they go on JW broadcasts and show all this relief they're doing. They're spending all these millions of dollars for relief, And the Jehovah's Witnesses in those actual countries are saying, no, you know, it's the individuals and other religions that are helping, not the organization.
So it's waking people up.
Exactly. When Maria passed, I wasn't home. I was in here. I was in North Carolina. It passed on September the 20th, and I got in North Carolina on the 15th. So when it passed, I wasn't home. And it took me 3 months to finally come back. I couldn't fly. Even that I wanted, I couldn't. There was no flights coming here. When I got here, we didn't have electricity. You know, food was kind of short. And I saw many churches coming house to house helping. I wasn't asking what church you go, you know, what church you visit. Nothing. They were bringing food, they were bringing water, they were bringing even radios, you know, battery radios, water filters, everything. None of the JWs I saw them coming wow. by and giving help. None.
Wow.
Nobody told me. Yes.
And I know, you know, quite a few people on the mainland here were upset because in our news they were showing pictures of these stacks and stacks of food and water and supplies sitting on the docks, you know, waiting to be distributed to, you know, the Puerto Rican people, and nothing was being done.
Exactly. Many of that food got rotten, you know.
It's spoiled.
You know, yeah, got spoiled because problem with government, problem with truckers and everything. And people, a lot of people die, thousands, you know, like over 1,000 or more.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yes. But like, you know, going back to the JWs, I didn't never saw one. Never. But then you talk to them and they say, you know, they, on the broadcasting, they only talk about all the help they are bringing to all the communities. I don't know where.
Wow.
I never seen any.
So
yeah.
It's just complete propaganda.
Exactly.
Complete propaganda, exactly. Especially, you know, when they showed that JW family opening up the freezer, the food is thrown away, and here's the
literature.
Yeah, and here's the literature in the refrigerator.
Well, even when the hurricane hit the Gulf of Mexico here in the United States a couple of years ago, we were in contact with PIMOs and JWs in Texas. And, you know, here is everybody thinking the organization is going to help them. And they had an elder come by in a suit and say, what can we do to help? And they said, well, you know, we're trying to clean up and we could use some food. And he's like, okay, I'll put you on the list. We'll be in contact with you. They never heard from him again.
Yes, they want to know, do you have insurance?
Yeah.
If you have an insurance, they help you out, and then they ask for the papers.
Yeah.
And claim that money. That's what they do.
Yeah.
That is nasty. Yes, that's what they do. And people still believe in that crap.
Yeah. Hey, that's words taken right out of my mouth. Do you have another question?
Well, I was just going to mention the march that the ex-Mormons are doing, and I can't remember the name of the organization. I think it was Protect Every Child.
Yeah,
and I'm going to put the link down below to the information on this march, but it's going to be October 5th, 2019 in Salt Lake City, Utah. And they're wanting, I mean, all they're asking for is even if just 20 ex-JWs can show up. And so I'm going to put the link down below, but if you want to tell everybody in Spanish, I would appreciate it.
It's going to be in Utah, you say. When?
Yeah, Salt Lake City, Utah, October 5th, 2019.
So what they're trying to do is have a combined march that includes the Mormons and ex-Jehovah's Witnesses and or maybe even PIMOs, if you can arrange it.
In the video, they did kind of like a press conference for this march with the information. But they said, if I heard right, there's 10 other groups that are joining this. So it's actually becoming like a coalition now of this march.
So it's going to be October the 1st.
5th. 5.
Oh, okay. Well, let me tell the people in Spanish. Aquí nos está diciendo que en octubre 5, el 5 de octubre va a haber una marcha en Salt Lake City, en Utah. Y ahí se va a reunir a los mormones, a 5 otras congregaciones o religiones, y estamos exhortando a los testigos de Jehová que por favor, testigos que ayuden, que vayan a la marcha, que hagan actos de presencia para que vean también y ayuden a todo esto, porque el fin es común y es el abuso a los niños. Así que por favor, si usted está cerca de allí, no falte, ayúdenos para que esta marcha se haga grande y vea que estamos en favor de las niñas y queremos ayudar. Muchas gracias.
Thank you.
Magnífico.
Magnífico.
Appreciate that.
Okay, now the question I have for you is that in a recent video that Kim and I have done, we showed Watchtower's little chart of where they're expecting to expand and do growth, and one of the areas was Puerto Rico. But at the same time, we know that there's a current Jehovah Witness in Puerto Rico selling off Watchtower's property. So how do you see that actually living in Puerto Rico? Are there really that many Jehovah's Witnesses there? We just kind of like to get a little bit of feedback.
Well, I'm like a type of person that I always hope, you know. I got a car there that is getting old without being used. But people sometimes call me and tell me, oh, wow, do you see this? Have you seen that this other church, that this Kinoa has been sold? I said, no, but they tell me that it's been, they are been selling Kingdom Home. But the funny thing is that I pass through a place where there used to be a Kingdom Home. It's a town close to my town. And I was driving with my sister. I was driving. She was on the passenger side. And she said, Nelly, wasn't there a Kingdom Home? And I looked like that. I said, yes. She says, there's no more Kingdom Home. They sold it. You know that the town is Arroyo. And they sold it. Then the people have to go to another town where my sister lives, because the name is Patillas. And they're selling, and this is a small island. If they sell 22 or more Kingdom Homes, that's a lot. That's a lot. You
yeah.
know, so you can see that people don't see it, or they are, I don't know what's wrong with them. When they have to drive to another town, they don't ask themselves questions like, what's going on?
Yeah.
Because I think everybody should know that you're the one that sent me the link to the Puerto Rican Kingdom Halls being put up for sale for that real estate. Antonio Gartini.
Yes.
Yeah, you know which one. But I noticed last night there's 2 more Kingdom Halls on his YouTube channel. So I need to check and see if he's just redone the listing or if it is actually 2 new Kingdom Halls. But I'm keeping an eye on him. I've subscribed to his channel.
Yeah. So that way, yeah, that way we know just how many Kingdom Halls are being sold in Puerto Rico.
I know that close to my town, there was across a golf course, there was a English Kingdom Home. It was English. And I remember that I went there once because I wasn't choosing, you know, when I moved, where I want to go, to the English or to the Hispanic congregation. And I went there once and I liked it, you know. And the people were nice. But then the driving, I was thinking of driving. Well, then the last things I knew was like, I said, wait, what about the Kingdom Hall here? Oh, after the hurricane, they used it at the base, you know, to sit there and talk about what they were going to do. And from the summer, after the hurricane, there's no Kingdom, not anymore.
So that one
went up to yes.
So they didn't rebuild that one.
I guess they're working. The is not there at Kingdom Hall anymore.
Interesting.
So would you happen to know, just off the top of your head, how many English-speaking congregations there are in Puerto Rico?
No, not really. No. You know, this is the problem. I moved in 2015, and then I left in 2016. So I couldn't learn anything about how they were doing, how many Kingdom Halls. And then from the southern, I left, and I get rid of everything that I have, telephones, everything. I only stay with the Bible because I want to rebuild whatever they do with their own Bible.
Yeah.
That's the only thing I have. So I couldn't have information. I couldn't call anyone. Because as soon as I left, they showed me immediately. I had this situation that I went to a local store. It was a Walmart. And I saw this sister that I love so much. And coming from the state for so many years, because I left from the 90s, and I used to live in Germany, then we moved to Hawaii. So I like to be speaking in English, because you know that's what I was speaking the whole time. And this sister, she was coming from the state too, and we have a good relationship. We love each other very much, and we were always talking on the phone. And when I left, and they mentioned my name, like a week later, I saw her in Walmart. And my immediate reaction was to go to her and hug her and kiss her on her cheek. And she was, her arms were down, her head was straight to the front, not looking at me, nothing, no reaction.
Wow.
Only like a zombie. I was with my sister and she started crying, because I started crying too. It was, you know, impacted me so hard, because it's a person that you used to love a month before, a week before, and from the sudden there was no love,
yeah,
nothing. And you know, I move out from the home, and she keep on walking straight, looking to the front, nothing. She didn't say anything. I said to her, I still love you, and I will love you. And I don't know, it was this year at the early month of the year, my sister told me that she died. It's only coming from the Kingdom Hall. And I was sad because I love her.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
That's the way they are. They love you this moment. And as soon as they say your name in the Kingdom Hall, they don't love you anymore.
Yeah.
That's the love they have.
It's sad.
See, and here again, this is another opportunity to expose just how hypocritical the organization is in their mind control, because they've taught us all to go from door to door, use the scripture in 2 Timothy 3:1-5, and you're going to read, and you know, the time of the end, there'll be no natural affection. They always take that scripture and apply it to the world, but they don't recognize it's them. It's the Jehovah's Witnesses that do away with the natural affection. And it's like, why can't you people see how you've been trained to be a people with no natural affection? They just can't see it. It's like, wow, how, you know, even when I was a JW, we had some apostates in our congregation back in Arizona, and I had no problem doing business with them on a, you know, business level. There was always this, you know, I didn't have a problem talking with, because I wouldn't talk, you know, religious matters, but just keep it on a professional level. And today's Jehovah's Witness can't even keep it on a professional level. They just can't do it. Yeah.
It's a conditional love. And this is the way they are. Let me tell you, I had this experience back in Hawaii. Because I went to the Hispanic congregation at first. I got there from Germany. And then I didn't stay that long, and I moved to the English congregation. Then, but we moved house from house. You know, we have, my daughter is to rent a house, and then she bought a house in Hawaii. So we have new neighbors, and but like 6 months into the living there, I haven't moved to the English yet. I was still in the Hispanic congregation, and they were preaching, right? And this neighbor, like three houses after our house, he was preaching there, and then he says, "Oh, by the way, I'm your neighbor." And I said, "Really? We've been here like 6 months, and I'm your sister from the Hispanic congregation."
Wow.
So my neighbor, I used to walk there, you know, with the dogs and everything, never say bye or hi to me. I saw him. Never say anything.
Wow.
And preaching, "I'm your neighbor. Oh, by the way, I'm your neighbor. I live in the house." So really, yes. I have seen you. Yes. I have seen you when I walk with my dogs and everything and my grandkids. Yes. To the bus. Yes. I have seen you. I'm your sister. I'm from the Hispanic congregation. And he was like,
wow.
You know, they don't care about neighbors. They don't care about no one. They only care about themselves, and that's the love they show.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's sad to be that type of a human being on this planet. It's really sad.
Well, then they say, you know, this convention about love never fails. That's mocking, you know, themselves.
Yeah.
The people know that there's no love.
Yeah.
People tell me. Let me tell you this, as a lady, a Cuban lady from Angola, living there, working there, she's living there, her and her husband. She says that due to the criminal things there, they barely go to the kingdom home. They barely go because they cannot preach there. It's very dangerous. And her daughter that left their country in the Caribbean and send some videos to her, and I'm sure that was one of my videos. And so she got into my last video and she sent me a message that she was so confused after listening to all of you know the activists. She was very confused and she needed to talk to me. I said, "Yes, you know, contact me by messenger." I didn't know that she was calling from Angola. When I saw Luanda, what? Luanda?
Wow.
That is so far, you know.
Wow.
We talk. And when I said, you know, "Did you ever see love? Did you ever see help?" Because she is, let me tell you, she is from Cuba. And you know how Cuba, you know, they are suffering too. Mm-hmm. She says, "Never. No help, no nothing. People from outside Cuba was helping us." I have to tell you, yes, I never saw that. And that was something that I was talking to my husband the whole time. Where is the love? Where is the love? People from Caritas is that is Catholic. It's like a group of Catholics. They call themselves Caritas. Caritas is like little faces.
Yeah.
That was the people that were helping them. Caritas and Mormons, the same people. They never received help from the JWs.
Wow.
And they said that they helped. So that was like putting a lot of doubts in her mind.
That was
putting a lot of doubts. But she said, you know, "All my family are JWs. My husband only have his sister, but my whole family. And when we going back to Cuba, what are you going to do?" But now she doesn't believe. She has so many doubts, you know. And I keep on writing to her and saying this and this. So she wake up and see the flower and smell the flowers. It's not what she has been told, you know. It's a different thing.
Exactly. And, you know, we're hearing the same thing is, so many are waking up because they're realizing there is no love in the organization. People who are studying will contact us and say, "I just stopped my Bible study because all I did was ask the JW, you know, teaching Bible a question. And they said, now, you know, I'm being shunned. And I went to the meeting and I'm being shunned. Yes. And they said, is this common practice? It's like, yes, because you're asking questions. So, you know, this is why they can't keep Bible studies anymore, because these Bible studies, all they do is ask a question, either something what they're learning or else they've seen a YouTube video, and then they're being shunned.
Yes.
It's crazy.
Yes. But it's good that they do that, right, Mikey? That they
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you bet.
Organization.
Yeah.
Hopefully they keep on doing that, you know?
Well, you know, it's like, you know, years ago, we did a video where my daughter made the comment about, you know, aggressive activism versus, you know, pacifist activism. And the whole point came down to cutting off the food supply. When you cut off the food supply, you cut off the cash flow. And right now, Watchtower is cash poor, because as a corporation, put the religion aside, as a publishing corporation, they need cash flow. And the only way Watchtower got the cash flow was by getting new people coming to the Kingdom Hall, putting money in the contribution box. That seems to have all but stopped.
Exactly. And they are losing them but fast.
Yes.
They are losing them fast, you know. It's every time that I get into one of my videos, I see new people. I say, oh my God, I'm here. Because I answer all the comments. I take time, but I answer every and each comment that they put there. And I know people, you know, that have been there since I started. And I see many people new coming. Hey, I've been watching your videos. I've been there, but I wasn't, you know, making any comments. I'm out. I'm an active, but I don't go anymore. There's so many people are leaving.
Yes.
They are doing such a good job, you know.
Yeah.
Good job. Yes,
see,
we are.
Watchtower trained us all too well.
That's what I said.
See,
what? One of those comments, you know, they trained us.
Now yeah.
We're using that against them. That is so awesome.
That's exactly right, because they taught us how to convince worldly people that they're in a false religion. Now we're using that same technique against Watchtower to tell JWs, you're still in a false religion. Nothing's changed.
That is so nice. Yeah. So you know, Mikey, like you said, Kim said, I'm the Hispanic Mikey. You know, I go against them, I mock them, I make fun of them, and I show them how they are.
Yeah.
And people love it because they know that I am right on that.
Yeah.
I'm right on that, you know. Like that Samuel heard what he did. The Zionist, you know, what is wrong with that guy? You know, that is so nasty, all his comments towards the woman. I don't know what is wrong with him. Some people say like, okay, so probably he's something else. You know?
Yeah.
Because he's nasty. His comments are nasty. They look at us, you know, like we still are cleaning the toilets.
Yeah.
But they look at us. That's what the only thing that they think that we can do, cleaning toilets, you know.
And washing that's windows.
We have been so far up to the moon. So he is damn wrong.
Yeah.
But
see, and this, and that's actually hurting them, because.
Yes.
When folks like us can take their videos to where they're trying to be funny or trying to be serious, when you mock it, people can see the truth even though you're mocking it. And they see, like a guy like Samuel Heard, just how much of a misogynist and woman-hater he is. And what amazes me is how many JW women in that audience were laughing right along with it. It's like, do you not see that this man is turning his nose down to women, and you're applauding him? You're actually love being, you know, demeaned by this man, and they'll just sit there and applaud. Oh, Samuel Heard, he's gonna go to heaven, and he's gonna rule over us for all eternity. Well, for all eternity, you Jehovah's Witness women are going to have noses turned down at you because you're still viewed as being subservient to a man. That's wrong.
Yes, I talk about that in my last video.
Good.
Last video about, you know, how people were running that. You know, it's like they don't listen. They are like zombies.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's saying. Like, they, you know, they laugh about everything. They applaud about everything without, like, listening exactly what he was doing or he was saying. And I'm going to ask you this, Mikey, because...
Okay.
I talk about this on my last video because, you know, the governing body is going to heaven, you know.
Yeah,
so I was asking people and telling people, if they're going to heaven, what about the 144 or whatever is the remainder are here? Because these people, that people, they are going to hide in some place. They're going to hide. That's what I think, that they're going to go to some place. They're going to hide in one of those bunkers. But what about the other that are going to stay here? They cannot hide any place.
Well,
what are they going to think about that?
Yeah.
They disappear and the others stay here in Earth. And it's going to happen.
Well, yeah, because that's a good question. What a huge wake-up call. Let's just go with the numbers that Kim and I were accustomed to before we left Watchtower. And it was like about 8,000 of those proclaiming to be of the 144,000. I know there's a lot more now because there's a lot more PMOs waking up and partaking of the emblems. But when you and I were in, there was only about maybe 8,000 Jehovah's Witnesses professing to be of the 144,000, the remnant. What a huge wake-up call it's going to be for those that are professing to be of the remnant when the governing body is gone and they're still here on earth. They're going to be like, Jehovah, what about me? I want to fight in that battle.
Well, I'm in contact with a Pimo, you know, who's a very dear friend, and her mother keeps telling her that she needs to come back to Jehovah's organization because someday she's going to come there and she's going to be gone. And she says, where are you going, Mom? And she says, well, we have our to-go bags packed, and they honestly think they're going to go up to Warwick,
yeah,
and be on that compound. And it's like, all 8 million, you know, you profess to have 8 million Jehovah's Witnesses. All 8 million are going to be up there in Warwick? I wonder how the governing body feels about the Jehovah's Witnesses thinking this.
I'm telling you, I don't know what life they're living. I don't know what they think and how they think about that. Because it's going to be a big surprise.
Yeah.
Because with all those lawsuits and everything that is going on, that people are going to hide. I'm sure. They have those compounds, those bunkers all over. You know, they have those compounds and bunkers all over the world.
Yeah.
They're going to hide. So, what about the... I believe that the last time I saw it was 18,000 of the 144. What are they going to do? Where are they going to go?
Yeah, exactly. It's
going to be a big surprise.
Yes.
It's going to be a wake-up call. It's going to be a wake-up call, and this is, you know, this is something that, you know, Kim and I have pondered among ourselves, is that if for some reason the government's come in and seize all of Watchtower's property, because let's face the facts, this child abuse problem is getting to be a worldwide issue. Governments are already seizing Watchtower's property. And it's only a matter of time before something here in the United States is going to break to where the government will seize the property. Because if the government sees Watchtower as a criminal entity,
element? Racketeering?
As a racketeering organization, they will seize the property. Because they're not being viewed as a religion. Plus, if Watchtower is losing all of these cases in court, and they have property that they're sitting on, then I can very well foresee the government seizing the property to pay these child abuse cases. And either way, Watchtower is lost because... See, and this is what I thought with what Zalkin said was so great, because it leads you to believe that this is a snare and a racketeering corporation, because that's exactly what they're doing. Because when they can get the Jehovah Witness to give up their money to build a kingdom hall, to give up their free labor to build a kingdom hall, and then Watchtower turns around and takes that property and sells it as their own, that is racketeering. I don't care how you slice and dice it and serve it up. It's racketeering. Yes, exactly. And that's what these guys are doing.
And you remember what they did in Russia? They took that Portuguese,
yep,
Portuguese assembly hall or whatever, and they changed, they switched name to a group of elders or an elder, and the government knew what they were doing, and they took it back, and it didn't pass to the elders. So they can do whatever that people they are.
Yeah.
They can do nasty things, you know.
See, and this
they
is
know what they're doing.
Exactly. And I know that it was an XJW that sent those documents, that found those documents and sent it to the Russian government. You know, I'm not going to say who it is, but I'll tell everybody a little hint of what I discovered, and I need to do more research on this. But you know how they're trying to say now the Christian Congregation of Jehovah's Witnesses here in the United States is what's running the congregations. Well, our friend Trevor, who's been doing all of this investigating and finding these files, he has discovered that anybody can go to the Secretary of the State's website in the state you're in. If you go to the Secretary of State corporation listings, their business listings, and you can do a search for Jehovah's Witnesses or Christian Congregation Jehovah's Witnesses. If they are listed as a corporation in that state, a whole list will come up and it will say active or inactive. Now, what's interesting is I did a search here in New Mexico, and when I did Jehovah's Witnesses, nothing comes up. As a corporation. So that tells me that most of the congregations here in New Mexico are probably run by a board of trustees.
Board of trustees.
They're not listed as a corporation. But when you put in Christian Congregation of Jehovah's Witnesses, one comes up, and that's Santa Fe. What the point I'm getting to is, what's interesting about this is, listed under the corporation listing, it says a foreign entity based in New York. So why does it say a foreign entity? And then I remembered that when Trump first became president, he signed an executive order that anyone who was caught being abusive and violating human rights, foreign entities, that their property and assets could be seized. So, you know, it's difficult sometimes putting these pieces together. You know, it's like a puzzle,
yes,
trying to do a puzzle without the picture. And it's difficult, but I know there's a connection in all of this.
Unless it's a foreign language
congregation. They immediately change name. You know, they got another.
Oh, yeah.
Another corporation, they create another thing. I remember back in North Carolina that they asked me to do my checks for the kingdom in a different name, like, okay, now it's not Jehovah Witnesses, it's Christian Congregation of Jehovah Witnesses. You know, so they have many corporations, many names, many things. So that's when something goes to them, they look for everything.
Yeah.
They're not going to lose any name, you know, because they are smart.
It's money laundering.
They are handling that business pretty well, you know.
And yes.
And it was hilarious. The country or something that you were talking that about, it was Belarus.
Yeah.
Just
real recently.
Yeah.
Exactly that. There were something about the law or something. I need to go back to the video.
Yeah. Ugly Watchtower did a video about Belarus this morning at Jehovah's Witnesses, but you can go and type in Google search, OSCE, United Nations and Jehovah's Witnesses, and all of these documents come up. And all of these complaints they're filing with the United Nations of how they're being mistreated, how they're not giving all these rights as a religion. And I mean, it's just, numerous, just several of these, you know, complaints they have filed. So, you know, that's why we said in our video yesterday, they're going to Satan's world asking for help. So they're making alliances with the nations and Satan's organization.
Exactly. I did a video talking about that because I saw one of the activists talking about a visit that he received from the elders, and he talked about the JWs and the United Nations, that they were part of the United Nations, and he says no, we still are. We still are part of that, but we do it because, you know, we have all these people that are going to different, you know, countries. We need their help. When, you know, if we still part of them, we need them. And I said on my video, so instead of calling Jehovah and praying Jehovah to help all those people that are sending to preach in different countries, they ask in Satan.
Yeah. Yep.
So they still part of them because they need their help. So they need the help of Satan to help, you know, the people that they send to other countries. Is that right? You know, they don't see that. The people don't see. That's what I said on my video. That is, you need to see that what they're doing, and you guys don't see it. That they said that everything is Satan. Everything is Satan. But they use Satan to help them.
Yeah.
Isn't them part of Satan too?
Yeah, and they just don't know how to deprogram from that.
Well, they, you know, go to Satan's organization for help, you know, because they're being persecuted in all these countries. But yet, when the news media exposes their child abuse problem, and these governments have all of these, you know, commissions and inquiries and Senate hearings and all of this about their child abuse problem, oh, well, then it's suddenly Satan, you know, attacking Jehovah's people. So, you know, here in this area, we have a saying, you can't have your cake and eat it too.
Exactly.
Yeah, talk about exactly. A dichotomy. It's like, wow.
So, I know that what we're doing is good, you know, we're helping people, and we have to continue, you know.
Yeah.
I was telling one of the Hispanic activists, his name is Franco Olcese. Mr. Franco, you know, he's been sick, and they closed his channel, the first one. He's been there for years. They closed it, and he didn't want to lose all the videos, so about 3,000 videos that he had.
Oh, jeez.
So he closed it, and he started a new one. He's sick, and I was talking to him this morning over a message, and I see he's like 70. So I said, Franco, I'm 75.
Wow.
I'll be doing good. So we have to continue, you know,
yeah.
We have to continue. And because we're helping other people, and we still can do it. So please, you know, get well and keep on with your good job, you know. So the old people, we're still doing good.
Yeah.
So why not?
Yeah, see, and that's, you know, that's something else, too, is that, you know, we have to help convince the Jehovah's Witnesses that what we're doing, no matter how we come across in our videos, ultimately, our driving force and the reason for doing this is because we do love them. We can readily recognize the imminent danger, and I've talked about this, you know, in past videos, that for the Jehovah's Witness, the danger is imminent, because you could be in a car wreck tomorrow and you could be on the operating table choosing between life and death, choosing to take a blood transfusion, choosing not to take a blood transfusion, and you know they're going to choose not to, so they're going to be dead over a watchtower, over a corporation policy that has changed. And it's like, you know, you cannot claim to be God's channel and in the 1960s proclaim that it's God's law that you do not take blood fractions. But now, you know, 2011, I think it was, when they come out, well, now it's a conscious matter.
Yes.
So, yeah, so the danger is real, and it could happen tomorrow. And it's love for these people and recognizing that tomorrow you're going to be possibly in a hospital room and you're going to make a wrong choice because you don't recognize what they said 60 years ago as opposed to what they're saying now. And it's like, it's very... Pardon?
They change from day to tomorrow, from today to tomorrow.
Yeah.
They change their policy, you know? And what about the people that have died already?
Yeah.
You cannot change that.
Well, see, now that's one thing that I would like to see happen, and I believe we're going to see it happen, is that once the Watchtower organization has been clearly identified as a publishing company, a publishing corporation, that I would love to see this taken to the max, because there is no statutes of limitations on murder. Once they can be identified as a corporation and not a religion, then their policies in the 60s regarding taking blood transfusions and allowing those people to die while refusing blood, I think we can turn this against them and start getting these lawyers to wake up and recognize we have another avenue that we can go after Watchtower, and it's for murder. Because whether you believe the Bible is God's word or not is irrelevant. They believe it, and they've made choices believing that God's word does not change. But yet, in their corporate policies, they make God's word change. And I think that if we can get some lawyers to really start thinking in those terms, I think we can hammer Watchtower even more and make them responsible for the loss of life.
Exactly. I believe that one of the broadcasting, they put a kid, you know, the parents talking about his son, the way he died because...
Mm-hmm.
And they put it like a hero,
Yeah,
and
martyred.
Seeing that the mother still crying because of the loss of her son, and they still put it there in a broadcasting. You know, that is
yep.
So sad. A lot of people still dying because of that stupid policy, you know, that doesn't have to do anything about that, because it's not about using a blood transfusion. Transfusion is something else. And then use it for their false doctrine, and it's not the people, it's the one that is dying.
Right.
They don't care, because we don't know what they do behind doors. They may be using blood too.
Yeah.
No. That people, you don't know what they do.
Yeah.
So, we'll see. We hope, you know, I hope that a lot of things, you know, can be changed. People wanna stay there and you know, because of their faith. And I'm okay with that. But I'm not okay with all those, you know, policies that are killing people, separating
right.
families and doing wrong to the to a lot of people. Like child abuse. They don't care about that, you know, the way they hide it, the shunning. If they change that and people want to stay there, that is fine with me. But if they keep on shunning, they keep on, you know, hiding child abuse, people are dying because of their blood transfusion. I'm going to stay talking. I'm going to stay here talking and say what I have to say against them.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that you guys are going to be doing the same thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Us too.
Yeah.
And, you know, I feel the same way. You know, if they want to keep believing, you know, their doctrines, that's fine. You know, they have a right to the freedom of religion. Where I have the issue is the violation of human rights and the psychological abuse, the physical abuse, the, you know, child sex abuse. You know, it's these abuses and the violation of the human rights and, you know, taking the families away from it. I got to tell you something. We were watching Goat Like Personalities video, and
yes,
and he's been in contact with the Mormons who are doing this march in Utah. And I was telling my daughter this on the phone last night, that he says in there that the Mormons say, "Oh my God, you know, the Jehovah's Witness is worse than ours on shunning." You know, so it's pretty bad for one cult to say, hey, your cult is worse than ours on the shunning. Yeah. And it, our daughter, she's like, oh my God. She says, that's pretty bad, you know, yeah. when one activist says, hey, your cult is worse.
It's worse.
You know, and I know we laugh, but I mean, it's true.
It is true.
It's true.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just.
I have to have some Mormons go away from my neighbors. The other apartment, and you know, I used to live in an apartment in the second floor, and sometimes they need like a room or something, and I used to, you know, to give it to them, and they use it, and they give it back to me. So there were like four girls, and doing their mission, you know, back here in Puerto Rico. So when I moved here, and they moved back home, they gave my number to the other group that came. So they called me like a month ago, and I was still in North Carolina. I said, no, I'm not home. Oh, we are the Mormon girls, you know, whatever. And I said, okay, I didn't say anything. I said, oh, no, I'm not home. You know, well, oh, so we're going to call you when you are back home. So they called me like, I think that it was day before yesterday. And then, Miss Nelly, oh, are you back home? Yes, I'm home. Oh, we want to visit you. I said, what for? Oh, because, you know, they gave us your number, and I know that you're in our specialty unit, something. I said, yes, I need groceries. I need to pay my electricity bill. But I was, then I laughed. I said, no, I don't need anything. I'm just, you know, making fun of it. So, but we went to visit and talk about Christ. I said, listen, I want to go straight to the point. I don't believe in your doctrine. I don't like it. And I don't want to hear it. But thank you very much. Thank you. I was in a cult already, and I get out of that. I don't want to go to anyone again.
Yeah.
Thank you. They were stoned. Because I was straight to the point. You know, I couldn't hide it. You know, because they're the same or worse. We don't know. They're the same.
Well, last week or so, I got a call from another XJW. And she was relating a story to me, and I thought this would be appropriate to mention it here. She happened to be going somewhere where there's a lot of people, and here's a couple of Scientologists set up in a little booth, and they were doing these free readings that Scientologists do. And they asked this XJW if they would like to have a free reading, and the XJW said, no, I just left a cult. And as this person goes past the two Scientologists there, she turned back and noticed that a Oriental person was stopped there, and this person was doing the free reading, and this person was watching all of this taking place, and the Oriental person ended up buying one of Ron L. Hubbard's books. And after the Oriental person left, she went back over there and started talking to the two Scientologists. And the one gentleman asked her, you said you left a cult, which one was it? You know, obviously, Jehovah's Witnesses. And this Scientologist said, oh yeah, I used to be one of Jehovah's Witnesses also. And it's like, how do you leave Watchtower and become a Scientologist? How does that happen? Wow.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Yeah. How does that happen? So I just had to laugh.
Oh no, I don't. I'm telling you, I don't want to go to any church.
Yeah.
I'm out of that. None whatsoever. No.
Yeah. That's.
You know, I pray and I do my things here in my house. I pray to God. I believe in God, and I still, you know, love God, but nothing else. Or anything about religions.
Mm-mm,
no way.
Yeah, us too. You know, and it's funny because other things, I'll be like on a website reading an article that has nothing to do with, you know, religion. Well, for an example, I went to a website trying to find out when the Age of Aquarius begins. So it was taking me to several astrology websites. Well, I start reading these articles, and then it's like, okay, this is kind of strange. So, you know, they give a date of like 2065, something like that, of when the Age of Aquarius is starting. So I go to another one, and it says, oh, you know, many will claim that it started back in the 1600s. But I have the right interpretation, and it's going to be 2020. And they go into this long thing, and it's like, okay, well, then I go to another one. Oh, well, it's going to be 2025. You know, I have the true interpretation. And I said, oh, my God, this is a cult.
The same thing. Yes, the same thing. They all have the truth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They all have the truth. No, 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 no. I'm telling you, I read my Bible. I have, like, 4 or 5. You guys got to have a lot of Bibles. I have, like, 5 or 6, And I remember I use it in one of my videos because of the is I don't remember I don't know how to pronounce the name in English, but it's Jefté in Spanish, the daughter, the one that remember that story in the Bible that is on Judges 11, I think, about this daughter that when the father came out. You know, or when the father came from
Jephthah.
What is the name?
Jephthah's daughter.
Exactly. So, you know, I made a video about that because if you read in the Bible, in the JW's Bible, the old ones, I don't know if the grade they changed it, but they said that he was put in a holocaust. So that is being burned, right?
Yeah.
And then they put her back in the temple. Yeah. So I did that, and people were known because I used like 5 Bibles that I have. And they all said she was killed.
She was killed, yeah.
She was killed.
A sacrifice.
Yep.
Yes.
Yep.
People wasn't believing me. I said, well, the mental control, the control of the information and everything they have over you. It's there in their Bible, and you guys read it so many times, I didn't see it. She was killed, but then they put it back in the temple, and the people were, the friends were there to, you know, to be friends with her again or whatever. They said it there clearly.
Yeah.
I make up, you know, in a holocaust or whatever, and people didn't see it.
Right.
I didn't see it either at that time.
Us either. There's so many that we read in the Bible now, and it's like, why didn't we see this as Jehovah's Witnesses? We didn't.
Well, one of the biggest thing about that entire story is that once a year, the women of Israel would all come together and mourn Jephthah's daughter. So if she was not truly killed but was, you know, dedicated to the temple, then there's no reason to mourn someone who's alive. Now, Watchtower will spin that once again and say, well, they mourned her because she couldn't have children. What a crock of shit that is. I mean, it's just bullshit is what it is.
People were like, oh my God, now we see it. Well, I presented a lot of Bibles. Listen, read this Bible, this other Bible. And they were seeing it there. I said, oh my God. Oh my God.
It's now they
see it.
Yeah, even.
But that's the control they have over many people. You know, they control what they can read in the Bible. They twist it.
Yeah.
So they see whatever they say, not what they read.
Well, see, and you know, and in my opinion, the crux of the problem is this, is that we've been indoctrinated that Western civilization is based on the Judeo-Christian Bible. I don't believe that because in the Judeo-Christian Bible, especially in Jephthah's daughter's case, even the Jews believe she was literally sacrificed. And we can't reconcile that we're praying to a God that allows human sacrificing.
Yes.
We can't reconcile that. I mean, the very first time that I did a video way back, it set some XJWs in this community on fire because I said Watchtower practices legalized human sacrificing regarding the blood policy. And that's what it becomes, legalized human sacrificing. Now, we've all convinced ourselves that we live in a modern day, you know, time frame. You know, we're much more enlightened than those people were back, you know, in ancient days that, you know, that practice human sacrificing. No, nothing's changed. Watchtower comes along, and guess what? We've all been taught that we're going to have to sacrifice our kids or even ourselves by refusing blood. That's legalized human sacrificing.
That's the way I see it, even
yep.
with the child abuse. It's
yep.
the same thing. It's
same
sacrifice.
Thing.
It's
yep, same
sacrifice.
Thing.
People don't see it, but that's the way I see it. The blood, death, and the child abuse is the sacrifice.
Yep.
And to who? Let's put a question mark right there.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, but see, those are the things that's hard for us to reconcile in our own minds, having been JWs. We are praying to a God that allows this, and yet we convince ourselves that we're living in a modern-day era, that, you know, we've gone beyond that. But when you really see... when you really, really see what that Judeo-Christian Bible is truly saying, then you realize we haven't progressed. We're practicing the old ancient nonsense in this modern day era. And it's hard for us to reconcile that.
Yes. A lady was telling me in one of the comments, my last video, about, I exactly don't remember how this... The situation started up, but she said, well, Miss Nelly, you know, we need to understand that the woman, I believe that somebody called me Pastor Nelly, something like that. And then she says she cannot be a pastor because, you know, the Bible says blah, blah, blah. It triggered me, you know. It triggers me because I said, listen, we don't live that time anymore. We don't live that time. What, you know, but, oh, you don't believe in the Bible? I do believe in some things in the Bible.
Yep.
But listen to this. Listen to this. If you believe in the Bible, you have to do whatever, everything that the Bible says. Otherwise, you're choosing to, you, it's like cherry pickings, you know? It's like cherry pickings.
Yep.
You do one thing, another don't do it. And what is that? If you want to believe in the Bible, you believe and do whatever it says there. Don't cherry pick with me. So what about the woman that are in period that they wasn't supposed to go to the temple because they were with the period those days of the month? So what you can go now? Why cherry picking? What about the woman that had babies and they had to wait for so long time then to go back to the temple? What about that? What about this? And when I kept talking and she left.
Yeah.
She left. Because it's cherry picking, you know, this, oh, this is good with my doctrine. Let me take this and let me take that. No.
Mm-mm. Yeah. And, you know, Watchtower does the same thing. They'll take some of the Mosaic law, like, you know, not to have any tattoos and, you know, several other things, the blood. But
yes.
Then, you know, they won't follow about, you know, don't shave your beards. You know, the men aren't supposed to shave their beards and all of this. And it's like, you can't just cherry pick this information. Good example is we just happened to mention in passing about the temple, you know, in a video we did yesterday. And I just happened to mention, well, you know, technically there may have been three temples. And I've been getting a lot of emails and comments, you know, saying, you know, we're wrong. But the thing is, fine, you know, I don't care how many temples there were. That's not important. You know, I got more things to focus on here, but it's a matter of perspective. If, you know, the Syrian Greeks went in and destroyed, you know, the altar, the idol of Moses that was in that temple, and all their sacred books, so what do you classify as destroying the temple? Is it them just destroying the altar, or does it mean taking everything of that temple down to the ground, just totally flatten it? So, you know, it's a matter of perspective, and everybody has a personal opinion of that. And, you know, I got a lot of emails, oh, you're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong. There's only been two temples. Well, the thing is a lot of people don't recognize that the temple that Herod built in 1 BCE, they don't recognize that as an official Jewish temple because Herod built it. So, you know, it's just a matter of perspective.
See?
What is exactly, what is the temple? It doesn't matter who built it.
Yeah, but yet, you know, if you want to listen to the Judeo-Christian Bible, Jesus obviously thought that was a real temple because he would go in there, you know, he cleansed it, and you're making my father's house,
even call it, yeah,
a house of robbers. So he viewed it as a real temple. So it's quite the conundrum, isn't it?
Yeah,
well, and that's where the word apologetics comes in, because they are apologizing. They don't realize apologetics is apologizing. Apologizing for what? Bad behavior.
Well, someone else in the comments, you know, and, you know, I love these people for making comments. They're entitled to their opinion. That's why I leave them up, you know, fine. You know, everybody can believe what they want. But they said, the Jewish people don't believe the Book of Maccabees is true, you know, and they don't follow it, and they don't view it as inspired. So I'm trying to be as nice as I can, and I just want to nicely suggest they do research. But it's like, okay, so why do the Jewish people celebrate Hanukkah then? Because Hanukkah is the celebration of the rededication of that temple after the Maccabean Wars. So if the Jews do not recognize the Book of Maccabees as being true, then why do they celebrate Hanukkah?
Because they got lost.
Is it true that one of those books has been mentioned in the Bible, right? Who did? One of the books.
Yeah, there's several. The Book of Jasher is mentioned. Yeah,
Jubilees?
Yeah, Jubilees. So other ancient writers have mentioned the Apocrypha books. But Christianity today tells us we can't read those because they're not inspired of God. Well, if the Israelites are God's chosen people and they're referring to those books as being a sacred holy text, then obviously they believe they were inspired of God.
Exactly.
But the problem comes is that when you start reading those books, those, you know, forged texts, it becomes too obvious who and what the nation of Israel truly are. They worshiped many, many gods. They had marriage alliances with foreign women. They did kill little boys and take the virgin girls for themselves. They did worship many other gods. They were no different than any other surrounding nation around them. Just like us, whatever's popular at the time, I mean, just like, you know, the idiot governing body member says, well, see, we only use the name Jehovah because it's popular. Nothing's changed. Those ancient people did the same thing. They went with what was popular. And if you weren't with the in crowd, the popular crowd killed you. It's right there in black and white.
Well, you know what they do always is half is true and half is so, but people still believe it, and that's the sadness of everything, because they don't see what they are doing.
Right.
They don't see it. This person that I told you, told you, King.
Yes.
Before we started the video, we were talking. And this lady, the old lady, the 72 or 73 years old lady that left with the daughter, they have a son. He's a better life. And that's the sadness part, you know, the separation. But they are violent people, you know. They places like that, you know.
Mm. Yeah.
But they knew that they couldn't stay there any longer, and they left. But that's what they do in, like, they don't see that. They don't see that they are separating families, like dividing families, they are killing people, abusing kids, abusing women. Because there's a lot of women, abusers. They are abusers, and they stay there because that's what they tell them to do. Stay there with your husband. You haven't been a good, probably you haven't been a good wife. And is that when they have sometimes been dictated by this organization, and some of them live and still be living.
That's sad.
Because they go to our channels, they are ex-JWs, but they still defend the court.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, I believe that. I said to someone that you need professional help. Because if you got out, but you still believing in what they say, you need some help. Because you're still indoctrinated, and that is bad. Because those are the people that they can be going back to them. As soon as they stop pushing the Armageddon things and whatever, those are the ones that that can go back.
Yeah, yeah, and they'll end up going back.
Yes, I would like to say something in Spanish.
Okay.
To the victims, you know.
Yes.
Me gustaría referirme a las personas que han sido abusadas sexualmente por esta secta, la maldad maligna, que están sufriendo, que están callados, sufriendo el dolor que le han causado. Por favor, no se olviden que todavía tienen tiempo de poder ir a un abogado, de poder decirles su sufrimiento, decirle todo lo que ha pasado, contarles lo que está pasando, porque usted puede ser ayudada. Y no se olvide que los abogados, la gran mayoría de ellos no le cobran nada para llevar una demanda. Ellos cobrarían algo cuando ganen la demanda. Por favor, no sufra solo, no sufra sola. Vaya a un abogado y reporte lo que le ha sucedido. Todavía está en tiempo de hacerlo. Y aquellos que viven en los Estados Unidos, se abrió esta ventana de un año. No permitan que ese año pase sin reportar lo que les ha pasado. Por favor, hagan eso. Y recuérdense que siempre, siempre estamos aquí para ayudarles. Así que no se olviden. I was talking to them about, you know, go to the lawyers and tell them what happened if they've been abused. And to remember that the lawyers, so most of them doesn't ask for any money ahead. You know, they
right.
Whatever they got is after they earn them, you know, or they won the, they win the lawsuit. So I was telling them to go to the lawyers. It doesn't matter
good.
Where.
Yes. And, you know, like we mentioned, Zalkin has started this new website, justiceforabusevictims.com, and it even says right there in big print, you know, you do not have to pay anything. You know, we will evaluate your case for free. So, you know, I think all of the victims needs to know that you don't need any money. You know, just call these lawyers. Many states, I don't know how it is down in Puerto Rico, but many of the states, even here in our little state of New Mexico, they have abuse of those who are victims of clergy abuse hotline. And they keep, you know, telling people, this is advertisements on the TV, you know, call this number. If you have been abused by any clergy, call this number. And many states now, I've been getting several emails of people saying that in their state, they have the same thing. They have lawyers advertising on TV. If you are a victim of clergy abuse, which includes Watchtower, you know, call. And even if it isn't clergy or an elder, you know, call. If you've been abused, don't worry about having any money. You know, just call and get help.
Yes, Kim, I don't know. What about us here in Puerto Rico, because we are not a state. So I have a friend that she was abused when she was 4.
Mm.
And we were talking about that, you know, because I didn't do anything. The guy was there. He was a son of one of the the members, but then he never got baptized, and then he got out. But she was abused, and the elders knew, her father is an elder now, and they didn't do anything. And she's been struggling her whole life. But I don't know, we were talking about that, you know, what can we do with you? Can we be able to put a lawsuit or whatever? Can she do it now that this window had opened? But we don't know, I think that is only for the 50 states. We cannot do it anything here. Unless we go to a lawyer here. I don't know.
Yeah, but you'll have to.
It's something to ask.
Yeah, you'll have to investigate that.
Yeah, maybe go to that website and see, you know, because I know Zolkin, even though he can only, you know, practice law in California and New York, I do know that he is part of this coalition of lawyers now, and they will help, you know, and I mean, even in territories of the United States, right. You know, like Puerto Rico and Guam and places like that, they should still have available to them lawyers that will, you know, handle this abuse.
Well, I would like to know about that. If you have any way that you can find about that, you know, you can look for information, please.
Yeah.
Let me know, because I want to help her.
Yes.
You know, she's been struggling, visiting, you know, visiting doctors her whole life.
Yeah.
It's a sad thing. You know, she needs some help, at least monetary. Yes, she deserves it for all the abuse and the suffering.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, that's what Zolkin, you know, keeps saying too, is, you know, these victims need financial help just to get the professional help from psychologists and to deal with this. And, you know, all of the abuse survivors I've talked to, they keep saying it's very difficult to have a normal life, a normal relationship, normal family life. You know, it's just almost impossible for them to do this because of the trauma they suffered. And so, you know, all of these survivors need help.
Well, let me tell you this, you guys. I was abused as a child. It started when I was my mother married with my stepfather when I was, I believe that 4 or 5, I really don't remember. And he started the abuse, but he never went all the way to a rape, because the same strength that I have now, I had it before. And I defend myself as a cat, let me tell you. But he molested me for years. And when I told my mother, when she decided that I was the one who needed to leave, because she never worked, she depended on him. So, you know, it was difficult for me. I had to go to many doctors, years and years, to cope with this. It's something that haunts you your whole life. Now I can talk about it without crying. But every time I used to talk, just to open the doctor's door, I was already crying.
Wow.
That was my life. It's a sad story. You know, all these people are being suffering by themselves in silence, and it's time to stop that. That's what I go so hard on that.
Good.
I go so strong because I suffer it. And then, as an adult, I work as a police officer, and listen to this. I work helping people, investigating sex abuse. So it touched me more.
Yeah.
I only stayed working as a police officer for 10 years because I couldn't go with that. It was difficult. Every case, I was living my life back then.
Yeah.
I couldn't stay there working. And I left the police department. Because I was working on that department on sexual abuse crimes. So that's what I see, and I try to help, because I see myself on those cases.
You know? I would imagine
people
so.
People don't know that what I saw, I'm so passionate about it, but that's because of that. It was because of that I was abused.
Well, I'm so sorry to hear you were abused, you know, but it, because of that, it's made you a great activist now for all of these other survivors, because you've lived that and you can be such a help to all of them.
Yeah.
So don't quit what you're doing. Just keep pushing, keep pushing.
Yes, I follow you guys, you know. You guys give me strength to continue to. Let me tell you, you don't know how much you have helped me. So
well, thank you
very much. I really appreciate it.
Well,
so thank you for everything.
Well, thank you so much. And, you know, that's what we try to do. That's why we started our channel, is, you know, just to help these survivors and those leaving Watchtower. Because we know it's very traumatic. Your whole foundation is pulled out from under you. And to realize, you know, that you've been living a lie your entire life, it's difficult.
Let me say this, Kim, because many people would think that it was a JW who abused me, and it wasn't. He was a Seventh Day Adventist.
Mm.
I was raised in that cult too.
Ooh.
He was a member of the Seventh Day Adventist Church.
Yeah.
So the problem is there too.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, you know, it wasn't the JWs, but it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Suffer the same way, it doesn't matter. That's what I need to talk.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for sharing, you know, your personal story with everybody, because it makes it hit closer to home and why you're such a strong activist against it. Yes. And I've had a run-in or two with an Seventh-day Adventist who actually does videos in the YouTube community. And I see it as both the same. But of course, you know, he feels he has the true religion. And he even told me that Watchtower was created by Satan as a mirror to the true church of his, you know, Seventh-day Adventists. So I'm sure you could do a whole video about that.
Yes. Well, Kim, you know, this is so difficult to talk about.
Yes.
And I know that for many people this is difficult as well. But we need to say it. We need to talk about it, because when you say it, it helps you out to heal.
Yeah.
At the same time, you're helping some other people. So that's what I encourage many people to talk about what happened to you.
Yes.
You don't want to show your face. I said, don't show your face. Make an audio, you know, so some
right.
people listen to it. But do something. You know, do something, because when you're telling other people what you suffered, you're helping others to come out and heal. So that's what I'm saying it to, you know, because I'm sure that other people will relate it, you know, or what I'm saying, and they will.
Yeah.
They will heal, and I appreciate that. Sometimes they're telling me, you help me, because when you say what you suffered, you're helping me out too. Thank you very much.
Yes. And thank you so much, you know, for being so brave and speaking out against it, you know, because I think it does help many people.
Yeah, it
thank
does.
Thank you, guys. Yes. Well, yeah, you know, it's a pleasure. It's been a pleasure to be here with you guys. You know, it's an honor for me, because you are my heroes. You helped me out to get out of the court. Yes, you did. You did, and I really appreciate it. I won't forget that. Because with your videos, you know,
well,
I'm
thank
sure
you.
I'm getting emotional. But you helped me a lot. You helped me a lot. Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, sweetie. And we appreciate you taking the time this morning, you know, to spend with us and all of our viewers. And we appreciate everything you and the other, you know, I'm going to say foreign language, who are doing YouTube videos, because I think this helps tremendously, because the word needs to get out. And giving your testimony, all of you, you know, all on YouTube giving their testimonies, you know, I think this helps, because it educates the world.
Yeah.
Of what's going on in this cult.
And all cults.
To repeat the Zogin website, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
People can listen to you. Is that Zolkin, what is the, no, Survivors? Can you repeat it,
What was in, yeah.
JusticeForAbuseVictims.com.
Okay. Justice for Abuse for...
AbuseVictims.com.
Okay. Okay, so can you put it in the... Put the link so... We can,
in the description,
put
yeah.
Put the link so we can... other people can read it, yes.
Yes. I will put it in Espinol also.
Okay. Thank you very much. Cool. So thank you guys for this time that you... that we talked. It was an honor to be with you guys, and I hope that we can do it again any other year.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
You know, and the honor is just as equally as ours, because for me especially, I love to see the older ones standing up against Watchtower. It's not, I want Watchtower to know that it's not just the young ones leaving Watchtower. It's the older ones also that are becoming tech savvy. They're not afraid to get in front of the camera and tell Watchtower and or its members, hey, this is what's going on. I'm of the older generation. Listen to what we're saying, you know, because it's truly detrimental to Watchtower when the older ones are getting in front of the camera too. So, I mean, this is an absolute joint effort. Young, middle-aged, older ones. This is a joint effort from everybody to warn the world what this particular cult and by extension other cults are doing to the human family. It's a cancer that needs to stop.
Yes.
Yes.
We're working on that. Thank you very much. I really appreciate this time that we spent together. It's been an honor. And I want to give a shout out to my friend Millie, that she always, Millie and Carlos from North Carolina, they always watch your videos. And sometimes I say, did you see Gemma Mikey? Yes, I saw her. Oh, I did. I want to tell you, you know. So, you know, for them, to Millie and Carlos, they left. When I left too, I called them and I said, you know, this is what's going on, guys. He knew already, but he was silent there. You know, he was scared. His wife. But, and when I called her, and she was like, Nelly, boy, you sure? Yes. And we keep on talking, and they left the same, like a month later.
Good.
So, you know, they are my heroes too. We left together, and that's so.
Excellent.
Yes.
Yeah, all the activists are our heroes too. And before we say goodbye, I just want to remind everybody, let me see if my Spanish is really bad, but Cinco Octobre? Did I say that right? October?
October.
Salt Lake City, Utah. And I'm going to put the link down below.
Okay. Cinco de Octubre, chicos. Cinco de Octubre in Salt Lake City, en Utah. No se olviden que va a haber una marcha. Queremos que muchos ex-dormis estén allí y ayuden a la comunidad también de mormones y otras comunidades que van a estar allí protestando. Por favor, únanse y hagan acto de presencia ese día, 5 de octubre de este año.
Gracias.
Thank you, guys.
We love you, Aunt Nellie,
yes.
And you have a wonderful day.
Thank you. You do the same. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.